We are podcasting from the Diocese of Raleigh Studios. Thank you for joining us on another edition of A Catholic Life. I'm your host, Billy Atwell. In September, the Holy Father, Pope Francis, is going to travel to the United States for the World Meeting of Families in Philadelphia, and he will also visit New York City and Washington, D.C., where, among other events and masses, he will address both chambers of the United States Congress. In this time leading up to his arrival, he made an announcement that has caused great joy for many and has been criticized by others. The announcement was that he will canonize Blessed Junipero Serra. The evangelization of California by Blessed Serra constituted a strong theme in the doctoral studies of a local priest, scholar, and church historian, Father James Garneau. Most people do not realize that many of our priests are not just pastors of our parishes and serving in ministry, but they're also academics, many of them. Father Garneau is director of the Diocesan Diaconate Program, chair of the Home Mission Society, dean of the Newton Grove Deanery, the Episcopal delegate for the cause of the canonization of Father Thomas Price, and he's the pastor at St. Mary of the Angels in Mount Olive. Father, thank you for joining me.
It's good to be here.
So what do you do with your free time?
I come and do radio interviews.
What was the last time you had free time? Maybe that's the question I should start with. So I do appreciate you joining me because I do know that you've got a lot going on. I know that this was a topic of particular interest to you, and I wanted to get your perspective a little bit on this. So first, did I pronounce it right? Is it Junipero Serra?
Junipero. Junipero Serra.
Okay. I don't know if I've got the role for that yet. I'll do my best, though. You correct me when I'm wrong. So tell us a little bit about the early life of Blessed Serra.
Junipero Serra was born in Mallorca in 1713 of a humble family, humble circumstances. His baptismal name was Miguel Jose, and he came to join the Franciscans and a particular branch of the Franciscans, which is important to note, a group called the Observant Franciscans, suggesting, of course, that some were not observant, but that is, in fact, some of the struggle of that time. Could there be a revival of the true spirit of St. Francis within the community of his followers, of his disciples, brothers and priests, the friars? And so Junipero Serra chose to join this more intense group, trying to intensify the spirit of Francis in the world. He was a bright student and was sent for further studies and finished with a doctorate in philosophy. He came to hold what was called the Duns Scotus Chair of Philosophy and taught in the formation program and a seminary for the Franciscans. Presumably was going to have an academic career within the Franciscan community. When he was very influenced by communication that was coming from the New World, Franciscans, of course, had been in the New World for more than a couple of hundred years, but there was also within the observant Franciscan movement a renewed enthusiasm to begin again the missions. They had in some ways become rather routine. And for example, many of the missionaries in the New World didn't speak the languages of the native peoples that they were there serving. There was a whole spiritual and methodological renewal within the Franciscans that inspired Junipero Serra to volunteer for the American missions. So at the age of 36, leaving behind the academic career, he went to Mexico. Another sign of the spirit of the man is, and then going back to that renewed sense of mission, when he got off the boat in Veracruz in Mexico, he walked to Mexico City, which was the first 12 Franciscans did 200 years previously, not looking for any recognition, honors as a priest, as a cleric. In fact, when he encountered indigenous people, he tried to honor them by washing their feet, actually literally. And arrived in Mexico City at the end of December in 1749. And from there began training for mission work among Indians. First, long before he went to California, in Mexico itself. Again, these particular Franciscans had established colleges to prepare missionaries for work among the indigenous people. And he became a strong member of one of those colleges in Mexico City and was sent in 1751 to the Sierra Gorda mountain region of Mexico, north of Mexico City, to work among the Pames Indians. He had learned languages and was prepared to work and spent 16 years there, long before he ever set foot in California. So he came to have this missionary perspective as really one of the fundamental points of his life.
What was his childhood like? Did he come from wealthy family?
Not at all. Not at all. Humble family. He did farming and that kind of simple work, which gave him hands-on experience when he got to California and established the missions, in establishing the kind of agriculture and husbandry that became the hallmark in many ways of the California missions, at least their economic base.
Is there a sense from any maybe writings that he left behind? You said he was intellectual, so I'm assuming he wrote a good bit. Is there any sense of what drew him to this kind of mission work? Because back in that time period we're talking about, I would imagine it's extremely dangerous work.
Well, you know, of course, the Mexican reality had been a colonized reality by the time he got here for nearly 250 years, although he is also willing to go out to the peripheries. To use an image of Pope Francis, he was kind of a – which is perhaps why Pope Francis is so interested in this man. He was always looking to go to those peripheries where perhaps the gospel needed to be brought in a fresh, new way, especially to these indigenous peoples. With whom he became quickly, you might say, enamored, whereas the kind of routine of 250 years had hardened some of the Spaniards to the indigenous reality, and seeing the Mexican Indians as sort of incorrigible, or we can't do much here, and still calling them quasi-pagans, he would treat them with the kind of respect that would move him to wash their feet and to learn their language and to gently call them, by St. Paul's phrase, the Gentiles to whom he was being sent, not barbarians or pagans.
Did he stand out to the populations he was serving, the native populations? Did he stand out as kind of a unique fellow with his reputation?
Well, he did stand out, and his holiness was recognized, and people did admire him. And, of course, he was intellectually sharp, and he was a leader, and he was humble. And so all those things with administrative ability made him stand out. But he was not alone. Again, the observant Franciscans were his base. And these colleges, one in Mexico City and one in Querétaro, were founded not just by a single man, but by a community of men who had this similar vision of a renewal of the Franciscan spirit, renewal of the missionary spirit, and being of service to the indigenous people who perhaps had never been presented with the gospel, or who had been presented to the gospel with the gospel in a half-hearted way, or not even in their own language. And so been made to obey, but not really given the opportunity to understand.
What made you interested in him? You obviously studied him, you said, as part of your doctoral studies. What drew you to this man?
Part of my studies was in Latin American colonial history. And so he's a clarion figure in that world, the later period, but just prior to the movement of independence, both by Mexico and other South American countries. But my Latin American studies is what brought me to understand Junipero Serra.
Now, during his life, he established a number of missions, is that right, throughout California?
He did. First, again, though, 16 years among these Pames Indians in the Sierra Gorda region, and then came to California. Now, here he is beginning his 50s, and a whole new mission laid open to him. And how did that happen? The Spanish crown had made a decision to expel all the Jesuits from the Spanish Empire. There's a big story there, and it's not new, and it's well told in many places. But the Jesuits were expelled by several Catholic monarchs from their realms and their empires. And in 1767, the king of Spain made that decision, and they were expelled from everywhere, both in Spain itself, in territories within Europe under the Spanish crown, throughout the Americas and the Philippines. They were put on boats and simply sent to Rome to fend for themselves, and the Pope needed to take care of them.
Wow.
It was shortly before the Pope himself actually would suppress the society, and the society would be done away with for a period of years. It was revived the next century by another Pope, but the Jesuits were not on the bestseller list of the Catholic world at that time. So when the Jesuits were expelled, the Franciscans were asked to step forward in a number of different areas. And one of the areas the Jesuits had been, where they had been ministering, was in Baja California. And it was to there, actually, Baja California, that Junipero Serra was originally sent. And he began his work, again, learning new languages in his early 50s to work with the Indians there. He was not there long. Upper California, present-day state of California, was kind of a no-man's land, but it was the in-between territory claimed by the Crown of Spain, but now beginning to receive visits from Russians who were coming down from Alaska. And the empire, the Spanish Empire, was concerned about that incursion into their claimed territory, but unsettled territory. And so this happened throughout the northern tier of the Spanish Empire. So not only California, but New Mexico, Arizona, Texas. These were territories that were little populated, but claimed by Spain. And so Spain needed to move to populate and take real possession in some way and create infrastructure and economic livelihood that would attract settlers in an increasingly rapid way as French, English, and now Russians began to move in and move towards their territories. And so with the Russians getting as far down as present-day San Francisco, the Crown settled on the Franciscans, who had this missionary spirit, and said, we'll work with you, we'll help fund you, we'll help transport you, and you have to help us. We'll send soldiers to protect you, and you help these indigenous people become faithful Hispanic subjects of the Crown. So there's a mutuality of purpose here for Junipero Serra and the Franciscans to bring the gospel to people who hadn't received the message of Jesus Christ, to the Crown to help stabilize the northern tier of the empire in the New World.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And those purposes, of course, would at times coalesce and work together. More often, actually, they would collide. And so the purposes of empire expansion and establishment and the purposes of the evangelization of the gospel would work across purposes. And Junipero Serra was in the mix, that he was the nexus of that conflict many, many times. And Junipero Serra in particular, in defense of the Indian against abuses by soldiers, by governors, by Spanish settlers, and Junipero Serra becoming a real hero for the indigenous peoples of California.
Well, there's a tremendous irony then, and that's a perfect segue into some of the criticisms that are coming out. You know, the fact that you're stating about him being a hero to these people, well, the criticisms are that he was not necessarily, that there was abuse. Talk a little bit about what those criticisms are and where there's holes in those arguments.
Sure, sure. The mission system was set up so that they would become self-sustaining. And so there had to, because the long trip from Mexico to resupply could take half a year or so up the West Coast by ship, and was dangerous. Those are dangerous waters. And so they had to become self-sustaining. Also, the civil authorities and the soldiers that were sent had to be supplied themselves. And so the establishment of missions by the Franciscans meant that a world was set up into which Indians could freely enter. And they always entered freely. They were not rounded up and forced into the missions. But if they entered into a Christian lifestyle, they would also learn the trades of agriculture and of animal husbandry and the other crafts and talents of a Spanish village that would make all that work. And they were very successful over the course of years. And after 40, 50 years, some of them became even wealthy because they were successful economically, which created other problems down the line.
As money usually does,
as
right?
As money usually does, and money in the hands of Franciscans especially. So
you're going to get beat up for that.
I'm going to get beat up for that, but it's always dangerous for their vocation. It really
is. Well, that's a good point with the poverty.
Yeah, and so to stay hungry with a missionary zeal for a Franciscan by means of their vocation must mean to stay poor,
right.
And the danger of becoming rich can corrupt the best of hearts.
Exactly.
So the missions were meant to be a place where, as Junipero Serra would speak, where the natives could taste and see the good things of the Lord, where they could hear the gospel, where they could eat. You have to remember that most of the indigenous peoples of the Californias were ambulatory folks. They were nomadic peoples. It was very primitive agricultural beginnings in that rich land. And the kind of cycles of water and drought that California experiences today, and I will not step into the world of climate change, but those kinds of cycles were known for centuries in California. And so when there was drought, especially, and the missions provided an opportunity where settled agriculture had brought irrigation and cycling of plant life and animal husbandry to supply for people's basic need of eating, then they became very attractive places to go to. And so to enter into those missions and enter into that life provided the Franciscans a place where they could learn prayers, hear the gospel, grow and understand the liturgy, and if they chose, to be baptized and to begin to receive the sacraments. It's when they got baptized that the relationship was presumed to be changed, that the neophyte had what most parishes long for, a real extended mystagogia, a real time of deepening the faith. We know in parishes today that sometimes people who come in with great fanfare at Easter vigils sometimes aren't even found in a parish a year later. Mm. That's sad, but it's true in too many cases. And so how do you allow the faith to deepen? How does the culture of the faith enter into a heart, into a family? And so the model of the missions was, well, you'll live here. You'll stay here. And once you were baptized, then you became truly a citizen of a subject of the King of Spain. And in a very paternalistic worldview, the friars would see their young neophytes as subject to the danger of reinsertion into the pagan and native cultures. So they were free to go visit their family and friends, but to go back and live was no longer open to them. For us, that seems such an abuse that their freedom would be so violated at that moment. Again, there was no secret to that. It was the practice. It was told. It was taught. Again, you might argue, well, people were hungry if they came in for one reason and then found themselves caught up in a system. You might argue, was it cult-like and difficult to psychologically leave? And then when they wanted to, they weren't able to. So if they did go back to their homelands, to their tribes, they were rounded up first by Christian Indians and then, if necessary, by soldiers. Because the worldview, of course, of the Spaniards and of the Franciscan was, we know this is hard and this separation we're asking for may be difficult humanly, but your salvation is worth more even than that loss. In our world, I don't know if people would agree to that in so many cases, even professed Catholics. What's worth giving up for the sake of eternal life? And yet at the same time, it's also important to remember that the kind of policies and the discipline within the – which is also pointed to with objection, which included flogging and public punishments of that time, of the 18th century – was mirrored, of course, on the east coast of the United States in Protestant English colonies, where people now can go to Williamsburg and see stockades and stocks where people were put out and publicly humiliated and flogged for all kinds of offenses that we would find horrific today.
Right.
Because the world had a sense of cultural unity that was necessary for a coherent society and for the protection of their spiritual lives. Which, again, today is such an individualistic view in contrast to that communal view of the time.
Some people look at that and say, especially that last point about, the public flogging, things like that, and say, just because they did it back then doesn't make it right. And they would say maybe that's a reason to hold up a canonization of somebody. What would be your response to that?
Well, again, the act of canonization by the church is not an act of approval of everything a candidate for sainthood did or said or thought. There are aspects of our lives today in what many people would see as a more enlightened time that may in 100 years seem inexplicable and very primitive and even evil to a later generation that might consider themselves more enlightened. So you have to see a person's life in the totality of their culture, while recognizing that there are eternal truths and objective morality. In the context of the time, of course, the Franciscans were flogging themselves. And so a renewed Franciscan spirituality, in which they were completely immersed and given to, would have meant a kind of medieval spirituality, whereby the wearing of chains and even painful devices that would remind people of the necessity of uniting every moment of their day to the passion of Jesus Christ would have been normative for the evangelizers.
Mm-hmm.
And not so foreign to them to introduce to the natives who were freely embracing the gospel. For us, the idea of choosing suffering, even a little fasting on a Friday, even only six Fridays in the year during Lent, seems very heavy. Whereas most of Christianity, from most of our lived experience of it for the last 2,000 years, has had a much more vigorous understanding of the place of penance in our lives. We're wusses when it comes to penance.
Five whole Hail Marys, Father? I got things to do.
Yeah,
that's... No, I think you're right. Yeah, and sometimes I feel like St. Francis, too, when people look at or they think about his life, if you actually read, he was a pretty intense fellow. He wasn't just this meek man that played with doves and bunny rabbits or something. You know, it's like he was a pretty intense spiritual creature, so to speak.
The kind of fasting, the kind of personal physical penance, the kind of a discipline of staying up for vigils at night, even individually, so that we might pray even the whole book of Psalms slowly, prayerfully, in the course of a night and sacrifice a night of sleep for such a penance, seems absolutely bizarre to a world of self-indulgence.
And in a world of self-indulgence, do you think it's those very things that are going to be attractive to kind of the next wave of Catholics, this, you know, an austerity that separates us from the rest of society? I think that's one thing that, especially when you look at millennials, you know, this recent research that's come out showing a decrease in religious affiliation, especially amongst millennials, and the Catholic Church, I think it was like a 3%, you know, decline in religious affiliation. Really, that doesn't change a church. And I was speaking with a porter, I was asking, how does this change? I said, all it's doing is reflecting what we've known for a while, and now the numbers are finally showing it. Like you said, people come into the church, they'll affiliate as Catholic, but then they don't attend Mass. Well, a priest is going to see that when he looks out in the pews and sees and doesn't see that face that he saw, you know, just a few months ago. Do you think these, not, I'm not saying, you know, flogging and wearing, you know, hair shirts and those kinds of things, but, you know, a sense of penance and a sense of we need some of these older spiritual practices to reawaken our faith.
Well, and isn't the movement towards even small Christian communities in all its forms a kind of a search for what Serra was looking for? How do we create culture to which people can unite their spiritual commitment in order to sustain it and foster it? So penance as an aspect of the culture, not the totality of the culture. Good Friday is not the totality of the Christian message.
Right.
But how does the culture get informed? And of course, in our time where the culture is deformed in so many ways and alienated from the gospel in so many ways, how do we do more than simply speak an 8-minute message on a Sunday morning that gets to the heart of the person and the heart of the family? So Serra is creating these. He established personally 9 missions in what was called then Upper California, Alta California, the state of California today. Eventually, almost 24 of these missions would be established. And they survived for about 60 years or so. There was always this tension with Spanish authorities, who's really in charge here. Actually, Serra at one point returned to Mexico City. Again, when a time when travel was very difficult, there were no roads between these places. And so he's committing himself in his 60s to go back to the viceroy, the king's immediate presence in Mexico City, for the defense of the rights of the indigenous people against the abuses of the military and of the few Spanish settlers that were coming up. Give you one example. In 1775, there was a revolt in San Diego against the missionaries, and one of the friars was killed. And it was Serra's intervention that prevented the death of any of the Indians in retaliation, including the one who killed the friar. It was his pardon and his explicit request to the governor that if he himself were to be killed or any other of the friars were to be killed under any circumstances, that the murderers would be pardoned. So that's the kind of spirit and attitude he held towards the indigenous people. I think that the objection towards Serra's canonization sometimes comes from a broad attack on the mission system as such and on the kind of abuses that certainly occurred. So, for example, Indians who died of venereal disease. In almost every case, so it appears by the evidence, didn't get those diseases from the friars, but got them from the soldiers. And in fact, as a result of that, and the Spanish weren't always sure where the diseases were coming from. They didn't have an understanding of germs, but they knew the abuses were there, and they knew the rapes were there. And so the insistence by Serra that the presidios, the forts, had to be miles away from the missions. At first, the governors would say, well, that's impossible. We're here to protect you. And Serra would say, we don't want your protection in this way. Mm. And so forcing the presidios to be more physically distant so that the Franciscans could live unprotected and unarmed among the people they're evangelizing was a fact of life, actually. And at times, like in San Diego, that backfired in a sense.
Right.
But they chose not to have that protection, nor retaliate afterwards.
And that's very the missionary spirit. I mean, it seems like that transcends even the Franciscans to a lot of saints that we know that were missionaries. They had that sense of like total abandonment to trust in God, that whether I live or die, this is God's will for me to live this way.
Well, that is in an ideal way the missionary spirit. But going back to say the origin of this missionary community of Franciscans, their own spiritual renewal was in part a response to the kind of spiritual lethargy of many others who call themselves missionaries throughout the New World and throughout Mexico, priests who were no longer even learning the native languages of the people. You know, in our own diocese, where now nearly half the population speaks Spanish, it's become incumbent upon us, who've in a sense prided ourselves on being a missionary diocese, now to learn a language that we didn't have to leave the state to encounter. Mm-hmm. In other words, to be missionaries here almost requires for many of us the learning of another language, which also symbolizes the letting go of one's own culture and the assimilation and the encountering of another culture. So that's what he was willing to do wherever the church would send him, and did it repeatedly during his life. Because when we talk about Indians, as we know, like with Hispanics, there's no one group of Hispanics, there's no one group of Indians, different tribes, a multitude of tribes. And even as he went up California's coast, he kept encountering new groups of Indians with different language groups. Hmm. And had to keep learning new languages through his 50s and 60s, dying about the age of 70, and is where he's buried today, died on August 28th in 1784, and is buried in Carmel, California, at the Mission of St. Charles Borromeo.
When you look back at the life of Blessed Junipero, what do you think is the greatest gift he gave the church in terms of inspiration for people? So when we read about saints, I think it's everybody does this. You look at it and you say, what quality should I have? You know, I can't have all these qualities. I may be a whole new person. But what do I need to look at and say, you know, I need to work on that. That's an area that I could really use some help. What do you, when you look at Blessed Seta and the work and the studies that you've done, what do you say? That is something that people should really look a little closer at.
Naturally, and of course, the first step, this giving himself over entirely to Jesus Christ and to his church and this relationship with Christ. And in order to be able to do it, the stripping of self. Not everyone is called to that Franciscan life in that particular way, but the willingness to abandon some of the things perhaps to which we cling, and whether it's material things or cultural things, attitudes, perspectives, being willing to be open to the need of this person in front of me. In his case also, and going back to Pope Francis's insight, the willingness to be sent and to go among the peripheries. Francis's choice of this man is really very powerful because Pope Francis has again kind of jumped the normal canonization process. Whereas Junipero Serra had been beatified, declared blessed by John Paul II in 1988, this pope announced in a kind of surprising way that he intended to canonize him, even though there had not apparently been a further miracle. It was the choice of the Pope to take him as an exemplar. And an exemplar of what? Well, recently when Francis went to the North American College, to the American Seminary in Rome, to talk to the seminarians there about Junipero Serra precisely, he talked to them about Junipero Serra as one of the founding fathers of America. Which is also very powerful.
That is a very powerful concept.
So those of us on the East Coast, and I grew up in New York, you think founding fathers, and it's Jefferson and Madison and the rest. And I think he's calling attention, the first pope from the Americas, the first Hispanic pope, to kind of the rest of our experience in the continent, and pointing to Junipero Serra, who until this time has been honored even in the nation's capital with his own statue, the result of the gift of the people of California, a decision they made in the 1930s.
Wow. I know, again, like I said at the beginning, you've got a lot to do, so we're going to close. But is there anything else that you think that we maybe didn't catch about the life of Junipero Serra or any of the controversy or canonization process?
The concentration of nomadic peoples into missions was a pastoral choice and model that created the missions. There were consequences, some of them tragic. No one knew how easily smallpox could be shared, people living in close proximity to Europeans who carried the disease but were immune to it. The Indians found quickly that they were dying, but nobody knew why. It doesn't seem a reason to accuse anybody.
Right.
But at the same time, they were also capacitated for living in community and with the kind of skills in agriculture and husbandry and talents and trades that would enable them to interact with the Europeans and the Americans who were marching across the continent who were going to come to those lands at any rate. And when the missions were secularized by the Mexicans and then done away with by the Americans, the Indians experienced a complete devastation of culture and sense of nationhood.
How tragic.
It was. But that's long after Junipero Serra lived and preached and died.
Because one of the accusations that he kind of caused that or participated somehow.
And so sometimes it's a broad brush against all intervention, all arrival into what's presumed to have been a pristine California coastline of indigenous peoples happily living together in peace, which was never the case. But if they had been left alone, they would have been fine. But of course, in the course of things, they were never going to be left alone. It's arguable that the mission system and the establishment of those patterns that I mentioned before gave those Indians that survived the only wherewithal they would have had to have sustained the later Mexican and American invasions of their territories.
Very good. You certainly know a lot about this. So what was in your PhD, how did you end up studying this topic in particular? Because obviously you're extremely well-versed. You know more about this than I do most topics, and it seems like a footnote in your academic career.
Well, again, one of my principal areas was Latin American colonial studies and then also North American religious history. And so this is a place where those two overlap.
Interesting.
And so that becomes a point of interest to me.
And particularly fascinating for us. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time, Father Garneau.
Hope it's helpful.
Absolutely. Thanks to our producer, Mark Height. You can download this podcast as well as others on iTunes and other podcasting apps. Go to dioceseofraleigh.org/RSS for more information about all of our podcasts. To get the latest from the diocese directly to your inbox, go to dioceseofraleigh.org and click on the email link in the footer. Check out our videos at dioceseofraleigh.org/videos. If you aren't already, make sure you check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. As always, may God continue to bless you and those that you love.